Why is it that so many are so willing to ignore something with such profound implications for their lifestyle, their way of life, their health, and the well-being of their communities? I'm talking about climate change. Do they need more evidence, more certainty? Or is it, in fact, that the ramifications and the implications need to be more wide-reaching? Or maybe that's, in fact, exactly why so many are so willing to continue to cast doubt on climate change and whether it's happening. Truth be told, climate is changing. It's already changed. If you're in tune with the natural world, you see the stresses and the challenges that ecosystems face. You very quickly begin to see the stresses of the animals and plants in them. The built environment and human needs have so completely dominated planning, development, resource utilization, that we've forgotten the role of those natural systems, and we don't see the stresses they're under, when in fact it is those natural systems that provide so many services to us, invisible services to us that are so important to us. I'm told a lot, well, we have a very, very resilient planet. That's true, we do. But that resiliency is being lost. Think about it the way you would a rubber band or elasticity. It has quite a bit of resilience, but the more you stretch it, the further out you get, the less flex there is. I believe that's where we're getting with our climate. I work every day to try to connect people to nature, to get them to breathe nature, if you will. Because I think those connections lead to voices for preservation and restoration. I came to Cape May because it is such an amazing place. I love Cape May. There's so much natural capital here. It's a special place on planet Earth. Yes, planet Earth. The migrations that occur here, that are occurring right now, are globally important. They're globally significant. The birds migrating through Cape May, the other animals that migrate through Cape May twice a year, rival those great migrations, the humpback whales in the Pacific, the caribou in Alaska, the wildebeest in the Serengeti. How many of you are even in tune with that happening right now? It's remarkable. Migratory shorebirds that fly 9,000 miles one way to refuel here every May. The horseshoe crabs spawning on Delaware Bay, the largest such concentration in North America, 5 miles from here. If you're connected to these areas, you'd better understand the services that these animals and organisms and ecosystems provide to us. I spend a lot of my time trying to rebalance ecosystems to help to set some things back a little bit. Whether it's restoring beaches on the Delaware Bayshore following Superstorm Sandy, or whether it's something as simple as planting native plants in my garden. They're small steps, but they try to replace a little bit of what is lost. I believe that collectively, those small steps have a huge impact. And what I'm going to suggest to you today is that we all need to have and take small steps to try to address climate change. We need 1,000 small solutions, and maybe that's the way we can get our hands around it. Climate change is a silent threat. It's easier to ignore. But we first need to recognize it's happening so that we can move to acceptance. It's so big, it's inconvenient. It doesn't lend itself well to politics. It's much easier to kick the can down the road. We don't have to address it now. I sit in meetings constantly and have people say, well, I don't have to worry about that. It's not till 2050. Or hear other people saying, wow, but I just don't know if it's really gonna happen. To which I say, what if it does? What if it is? Because it already is. We need to move out of what I like to call the climate change denial bubble. We spend so much energy in this society, in our country, debating and arguing, is it happening? Did it happen? Are the projections right? Well, they're off a little bit. We spend so much negative energy that we're not actually addressing the problem. We're so far behind in dealing with climate change. I believe we'll ultimately do the right thing, but boy, we're taking it right to the edge. We are way behind. How do we move out of that denial bubble? How do we do that? It's not about data. I'm data-driven. It's not about data. Because if it were about data, we'd be well on our way already. Here's a graph for you. It says in the Northeast, we've already measured. We're not talking about projections and predictions for the future. We've already seen more than 70% increase in very heavy precipitation. If you were in New England last winter, you wouldn't argue with this stat. If you were in South Carolina 2 weeks ago, you wouldn't argue with this stat. Maybe we could talk about New Jersey. The last 8 warmest summers have been in the last decade. We could talk about 6 of the last 10 years, major floods. We could talk about Irene or Sandy. We could talk about drought this last year. It's all about extreme events. The U.S. has the largest percentage of climate change deniers of any of our wealthy nations. Only a third of Americans worry about climate change. Yet our natural systems are already being impacted. They have tolerance limits. And people say to me, well, I just don't know. But I'll tell you, it's the rate of change that we see in our climate that should give us pause. Today I'm going to focus on sea level because it's one of the most visual of the effects of climate change. And I think that if we could see it, maybe we could embrace it and start trying to solve the problem. It also matters quite a bit if you live kind of at zero. You know, we live down here, we're at sea level. So sea level moving a little bit should be something we pay a lot of attention to. If you live near a coast in the U.S., that's half the U.S. population, 160 million people. In New Jersey, that's 60% of the population, 5 million people. Small changes matter a lot. Our entire economy is based around the coast and being near the coast. This community is all about seaside resort of Cape May. Huge amounts of industry and infrastructure situated along the coast. What do we have to lose by starting to address climate change? Sea level's rising. There's no mistake about it. We measure it, we see it. This could be my comic slide. Who builds a railroad on a beach? The answer is nobody. The beach came to the railroad. This is on Sunset Beach, exposed in a storm a few years ago, just down the road. So infrastructure is already being impacted. Here's a graph of sea level. I'm a data person, even though I know data isn't going to do it, but I still have to show you some data. This is a graph of measured sea level from 1910, basically to present. It's in Atlantic City. I could have used Cape May. I could use sea level gauges from all over the East Coast. The reality is, since 1980, sea level has risen 6 inches. That's more than a foot, 1.3 feet, in the last century. What's more alarming is that rise rate since 1993 is 2 times as fast as it was prior to that. These rates are tracking those global predictions that no one wants to listen to. It's stressing ecosystems. It's eroding our beaches. It's flooding our streets. It's drowning our marshes. I drive a road through a marsh twice a day, probably 300 times a year, and this is what I see. I see marshes that are flooded routinely every spring, tide for several days, perfectly sunny days. It didn't happen in 1980, didn't happen in 1990, didn't happen in 2000, it's happening now. It doesn't matter if you think that humans are causing climate change or contribute to it in any way. Climate change is causing the ice sheets to melt. That water is running into the ocean. The level of the ocean is rising higher on the land. This is the result. This matters a lot. New Jersey also has one other thing to have a chip on our shoulder about. We're actually in a place where the ground is sinking, making this a little bit worse, even still. We can see everything in the yellow there. The rise rates here are 1 to 2 feet per century. The projections are that it'll go another 1.5 to 2 feet in the next 100 years. This is static rise. We see it during storms. This is Hurricane Sandy. We add storm tides to flooding. And now I'm not so worried about 2050, I'm worried about tomorrow. I'm worried about last week. I'm worried about the other 50 storms, smaller storms we'll get in a given year. A storm the size of Sandy, if it had struck in 1880, would have flooded 27 square miles less than happened in Sandy. Just a simple difference in that sea level. Marshes did a great thing for us. in Hurricane Sandy. We know that. Where we had marshes, they helped us quite a bit. We have great wealth of marshes here in South Jersey, part wisdom, those that preserved them, partly our geography. This is what a healthy marsh looks like. It's got a sloped surface. Marshes are remarkable. 1 acre of wetland can store about 1 million gallons of water in an acre. It's pretty remarkable. Marshes keep pace with sea level. They actually do fairly well in rising sea level because they have the ability to build that surface. A healthy marsh, the top surface, is about at mean high water. They do this by trapping sediment, but they also do it by putting down massive root mats, and those root mats hold the surface. If sea level rises too fast, they start growing slower. They don't want to be flooded that often. The more they flood, the slower they grow. The slower they grow, the more they sink. And that's what we're starting to see. They generally can keep up. If the rate of rise is too fast, they start to give up. This is what it looks like out my window. I have a great view, but I'm starting to be concerned about what I see. I see flooded marshes way too frequently. The lower photo was taken 2 weeks ago. We had high winds and storm tides. The marsh was doing its job. It absorbed billions of gallons of water. But how long can you keep doing that? On your right is what it starts to look like as the marsh starts to drown. I see that as well. The marsh is growing slower. We're seeing open patches in the marshes that are getting larger. And this is concerning to me. I see change. I see it out my window. Our marshes, in some ways, are the canary in the coal mine. This is what climate change looks like in the way of sea level rise. It's taken on Delaware Bayshore. This is a marsh migrating to the landward. It's a forest that's now been flooded, so the trees died. So all that gray is dead trees. This is what marshes do. They move landward. This is actually a good thing to see this, because it suggests that that marsh had the ability to move to higher elevation. We need that to be able to happen, because the deeper part of that marsh is drowning. So this is reestablishing its position. So many of our marshes, though, can't move. They're backed by bulkheads, roadways, houses. We've decided we don't want them to move. We want them to stay right where they are. The alternative to this, then, is for them to drown. We're losing an acre of wetland every day in Delaware Bay, an Atlantic Coast region here. An acre a day, silent loss, critical ecosystem. These support our fisheries. Our commercial fisheries are so important here. They support our wildlife, birds, the intrinsic beauty of what is Cape May. Yet we're losing them. We're losing them to sinking. We're also losing them laterally. A combination of boat wakes, taking these big chunks off the side of the marsh. So we're losing marshes in both directions. Can you imagine Cape May without marshes? And these silent services that they provide for us. The signs of change are everywhere, if you know what to look for. My goal is not to be here today to make you feel helpless about climate change. Probably did that, but that wasn't my intent. I'm hopeful. I'm here today to tell you I am hopeful. I'm trying to move the dialogue about climate change from debate and denial to problem solving and planning. We all have a role to play. Everyone in this room has a role to play. Let's help change the energy from negative about climate change to positive. Let's be the agents of change. What do we have to lose by engaging? We need to be planning. We need to be talking about it. We need to be implementing. We need to be adapting. We need to take it to our public officials and insist that they plan for our communities. They're not. There's very little discussion. There's some planning, not as much as needs to happen. Here's an example of something that is being done. This is an example where we're trying to test some opportunities to raise the marsh a few inches, 6 inches, 8 inches, using dredge material, clean dredge material. The idea being raise that marsh back to the sea level, let the grasses grow through again, try to offset some of that rise. There are projects using living shorelines to try to use natural systems to fend off some of that marsh edge erosion I showed you. We need to use in our natural systems to restore and protect the services that they provide for us. We can't do it without them. I see climate change in so many ways, in so many places. It's time to start a wave of change. It's not the scientists that are going to change this debate to moving it for action. We've been trying for decades now, and it isn't working. So I'm trying to have you see climate change. I chose to focus on wetlands. Kind of spent a lot of my time in wetlands. That's where my heart lies. But you can choose any aspect of climate change that you find personally important to you. Pick something personally important. There has to be some common ground here. If you see evidence of change, report it. I saw it, set up this hashtag, see climate change. Report it. Talk about it. Tell your neighbors about it. Think about it. How does it affect you? Let's take the discussion out of the debate about the uncertainty of the predictions, the observations, and go right to what we see is happening to our community every day. Once we see the change, we can find ways to work on it. I believe we'll take 1,000 small steps and thousands of voices asking for the change that we need. If you're not part of the solution, you know how it goes. You're part of the problem. Be part of the solution. Let's take those 1,000 small steps, because that's an idea worth sharing. Thank you.